Actually, just one simple trick that that has to strike you, then it becomes pretty clear. So we have this H is a proper subgroup. Ah, by the way, I think I have yes, I have made a mistake in stating of the GRH, the consequence of GRH. When I say q square root x log square x, this is not true. The q is here. Square root x log square q x. Maybe this is what stopped you from proving it. Yes. What? So H is a subgroup of ZQ star. It's a proper subgroup. Okay. So let's define a character, or not define. There are characters already defined. Pick up a character which is all one on entire H, but it's not trivial. Such a character always exists. You just, H is a subgroup, you send H to 1 and then define, you can, they still have many possibilities of choosing the character. This character group size is same as the ZQ star. Okay. So fix this. Now consider this quantity. Okay, this is sum of 1 minus chi n whole times lambda n, n less than equal to x. Now let's think about this quantity for this sum for a moment, and what we are interested in knowing is when is this sum all 0. Okay, or let's put it slightly differently. Suppose between 1 and n, all elements of ZQ star are in H. One in X intersection ZQ star is a subset of H. Then what is this sum? Zero, right? Whenever n is in ZQ star, chi n is 1, so this is 0. Whenever n is not in ZQ star, then lambda n is 0. Lambda n is non-zero only when n is a prime power. If n is not in ZQ star, which is a non-trivial GCD with q, yes, and we are saying that x is less than q. If q is small, then anyway there is not an issue. Okay. Now, so this is 0 if this happens. Now what we want to show is that in the range 1 to log n log q to the 4, there is an element which is not in ZQ, not in the group H. So if we can show that this sum is non-zero when x is log q to the 4, and then clearly it is less than q, right? That's the condition we want to ensure, which is trivial to ensure. Therefore, if log to the 4 q then okay, so for now let's see what this is equal to. We already know what this is equal to. What is this, the first quantity, the first sum equal to? What? Well, first of all it is psi x, and the second one is psi of x of chi, that is by definition. And now use GRH. If GRH is true, then psi x equals x plus order square root x log square x, and if GRH is true, then what is psi x of chi? See, chi is non-trivial. For trivial character, it is the same quantity x plus order square root x log square q x, but if chi is non-trivial, then this is simply order square root x log square q x, which is x plus order square root x log square q x. Now this would be 0 when this error term is equal to the principal term and it has the opposite sign. But for certain, see, but asymptotically the principal term is much bigger than the error term. So at what point does it become bigger and stays bigger forever? When x is less than square root x log square q x, if and only if x is bigger than log to the 4 q x. So if x is bigger than, let us say, c cube log to the 4 q, will that be sufficient? It would, okay, log to the 4 q, yeah, that is sufficient. Okay, or instead of c cube, we can say some 10 c square something, that is not really important, and that is it. So that means if I look at the interval 1 to x, where x is order log to the 4 q, I am guaranteed to find an element which is outside any proper subgroup of ZQ star.
So when we said the sum should be 0, the elements for which n is n has some GCD with Q, and still it can be a prime power and it has GCD with Q.
Okay, that's true. How do you handle this? If n is a prime power and the entire prime, this prime must divide q, that is the requirement, right, then it will have a non-trivial GCD and therefore lambda n is not 1. Chi, oh, what is chi n then? Chi n is 0, chi n by definition is 0. So then this is not, that is certainly, the sum will be non-zero. So then I will have to count number of such occurrences. So the sum will not be 0, but what one can see is that sum is going to be very small. See, x is only going up to log to the 4 q. So we are only looking at prime divisors of q which are very small. And for each such prime divisor, lambda n is log of that. So if you sum it all up, so sum of logarithm of all prime divisors of all small prime divisors of Q, that is going to be a very small quantity. Or is it necessarily a small quantity? Yes. It has to be a prime power. So this, see, there are a small prime number, and we are going up to only log to the 4 q, so that will if say prime p divides, which is prime p itself is very small, it divides q. So, we will go up to a small power of p only, right. The power of p we go up to is log log q, right. And actually it does not matter what power of p we go up to, because that is this only log p that will get counted. So, log p, so p itself is less than equal to log to the 4 q. So, log p is log log q. And how many such primes will exist? There can be at most log q such primes, because their product is going to be q, right. So, log q times log log q is the maximum value of this sum. And then we go here and again do the same thing. So, 0 is not that important, because this gap is going can be made fairly large, right. For an appropriately chosen constant here, this gap would be log to the 4 q, which is way beyond what is allowed. So, it would not matter, but that is a good point that we have to be careful here. So, a corollary of this is that you look at all elements of ZQ star less than equal to log to order log to the 4 q, they must generate the entire group, because if they do not, then there is a they generate a subgroup, and then that is not possible. And there are other many many other corollary, like a quadratic non residue modulo a prime. If you right, that now you want to find given a prime p, you want to find a quadratic non-residue modulo p, which is used in factoring quadratic polynomial. If a whatever, so if you have to factor polynomial like x square minus a over f p, then you the one convenient algorithm is that if you have available one quadratic non-residue, then using that non-residue you can in polynomial time factor the polynomial. Now, how do you get a quadratic non-residue? Well, use this theorem. Start searching from 1, 2, 3, 4 and checking if a number is quadratic non-residue. You know how to check a if a number is quadratic non-residue? Raise it to p minus 1 modulo p and see if you get plus 1 or minus 1. That is the correct p minus 1 by 2, p minus 1 will always get you 1, raise it to p minus 1 by 2 and you get a plus 1 or minus 1. So, you keep checking. Now, one of the first log to the 4 p numbers has to be quadratic non-residue if g r is true, because set of quadratic residues form a proper subgroup of z p star. Finding a quadratic non-residue in FP. The other application is Miller's algorithm for primality testing, but I am not going to describe the algorithm. If you go and look it up, it is a deterministic algorithm. It is polynomial time and it claims that the GRH is true. And the reason for the claim is that it again tries to do the same thing. It computes a subgroup of ZP star or the number, say Zn star. The n is the number it wants to check if it is prime or not. So, it looks at the Zn star, then identifies a subgroup, proper subgroup of Zn star, and is looking for an element outside this subgroup. And if that element is available, then the algorithm becomes polynomial time. And this is the way to find that element. You just run this, you know, throw it big hammer of GRH at it, you get a polynomial term. Okay. So, any questions?
So, without GRH, this closest bound is at log 4 q.
No. Without GRH, the best bound known is square root q. So, there are lots and lots of problems which will, whose solution will become easy if GRH is true in all kinds of fields, diverse fields. For example, finding say we know that between n and 2 n there exists a prime for every n. But what one would like to do is to shrink this interval and show that n and 2 n, I mean it is obviously there must exist a prime, and then one must be able to shrink this interval and say that between n and n plus something there must be always be a prime. Now, if GRH is true, then you can show that between n and n plus n to the 1 plus epsilon, if I remember correctly, there must be a prime for any epsilon. No, what am I saying? No, n to the 1 plus, what am I saying? Between n and n plus n to the epsilon, yeah, there must be. So, the interval, the gap is only n to the epsilon, but in fact GRH is not strong enough actually to fully satisfy us here, because here what is believed is between n and n plus order log square n there must be a prime, but that is not, that does not follow from GRH, but it is believed to be correct. Now, of course, I have said already much about the Riemann hypothesis, but one final thing I want to say is that it has some, apart from its fundamental importance to mathematics, seems to have very curious connections with physics. There is a theory called quantum field theory in physics. I do not know about that anything, but what I have read, it basically models the quantum phenomena, and in that there is a particular, the governing matrix, which is a huge matrix, and the eigenvalues, it is an infinite matrix by the way, and eigenvalues of that matrix are precisely the zeros of the zeta function. And so that connection was discovered not too long ago, and it was quite a remarkable insight that the zeta function has something to say about a physical theory as well. So anyway, if you are guys interested, feel free to read that up. I still have time, which is good, because now I want to change track. I have about 4 lectures, and in this I would like to do the following. I will give you an example of zeta function, of a different kind of zeta function, that is, and the example is over elliptic curves. And so let me just create a new template. So, in fact, there is a full theory of this. Zeta function can be defined over many different objects, in particular over all 2-dimensional curves. And there is a corresponding Riemann hypothesis associated with it, and that hypothesis has actually been proven. And in fact, I will prove the Riemann hypothesis for elliptic curves. And the Riemann hypothesis there also is the same, that all the zeros, non-trivial zeros, lie on the line real z equals half. Now, elliptic curves are interesting for many other reasons as well, and that is why I thought I should do this, because once I prove this, I will show you the connection between the zeta function for elliptic curve and not just zeta function elliptic curve, actually any Dirichlet series. Dirichlet series is the zeta function's original expression of the kind sigma. So, we have that is for example, this zeta z equals 1 over. So, this such infinite sum is called a Dirichlet series. And the reason it is called, well, because it was defined by Dirichlet, but it is a infinite series, and then there is another quantity called power series. This is a more familiar quantity, which I guess would be corresponding to this, the power series would be say P of z equals sigma n greater than equal to 1 z to the n. So, z to the n is the familiar infinite power series, right, where n keeps increasing. Dirichlet series is a, it is n to the z, so it just flips the thing and takes it in the denominator. And in general, there would be coefficients here, like in case of L functions, we have chi of n here. So, whatever coefficients are here, we can stick those coefficients here. So, these Dirichlet series and power series, we can create this duality between the two. And what has been shown is that if Dirichlet series has a certain structure, which is that it is meromorphic over the entire complex plane, whatever the function, it can be extended to be meromorphic over the entire complex plane, and it has satisfies a functional equation like the zeta function does. And one more property, I think the size of the coefficient should not be very large, then the corresponding power series becomes what is called modular form, okay, and vice versa. So, again, maybe I should not jump into this all right away. So, let us forget about this. I will come back to this. Let me first focus on zeta function over elliptic curves. But eventually, in the last lecture, I want to connect all of this up to the Fermat's last theorem and how that was shown using the ideas from elliptic curves, modular function, zeta function, and so on. Okay, so now what are elliptic curves? Do all of you know the definition? You know, two of you? Okay, so elliptic curves are cubic curves. We all know completely the quadratic curves, cycle, parabola, hyperbola, ellipse. These are the four types of quadratic curves, and the simplest next curve is elliptic curve, typically given by equation y square equals x cube plus ax plus b. And there is another condition we attach to this, 4a cube minus 27b square should be non-zero. That is essentially to ensure that the right hand side, which is a degree 3 polynomial in x. So, it is a degree 3 polynomial in x, so it will have 3 roots. So, I can rewrite right hand side as x minus alpha, x minus beta, x minus gamma. So, this condition is equivalent to saying that the right hand side does not have repeated roots. Because if it has repeated roots, then the curve is sort of degenerate, and we do not want that situation to occur. That is all. So, it is a very reasonable condition to assume. So, how does an elliptic curve look like? Let's take some example. Suppose y square equals x minus 1, x plus 1. So, I am just writing it in this form. Of course, this, if you multiply this out, okay, it is in this form. So, that is good. So, this is x square minus 1 times this. So, how does this curve look like? So, I am now over reals. I am not over the complex plane. So, over reals, how does this look like? So, clearly at x equal to 1, y is 0, x equal to 0, y is 0, and x equal to minus 1, y is 0. Y is 0 at all these 3 points. For x between minus 1 and 0, what happens? I should ask for the first one. For x less than minus 1, what happens? For x less than minus 1, this is negative. This is negative and this is negative. The product is a negative number, and then y square equal to a negative number on over real, there is no solution. It does not exist solution. So, the curve does not exist to the left of minus 1. What about between 0 and 1? Same, it is the product is negative. So, again the curve does not exist between 0 and 1. So, do a little bit more thinking about it. So, we will find that the curve will look like something like this. So, this part is a closed curve and this part is an infinite curve. And this is a general form of an elliptic curve. There is one piece which is closed curve and one piece which is an infinite curve. Now, these look like ellipse and parabola, but they are not. These are cubic curves. So, this is not really an ellipse, but it is symmetric along x axis because it is y square. Okay. Now, elliptic curves are just probably the most remarkable curves in whole of mathematics. It is just unbelievable the kind of properties they have. And they all arise because of a group structure which sits on these curves. One can define, so we look at, let us see. So, let us say E of, so that is our real. So, we can say take any Q, a set of this notation E of Q to denote the set of rational points lying on the elliptic curve given by E. Okay, when I say rational point, I mean a point here whose coordinates are rational. E of R, so this of course can be generalized to say E of R. E of R is the entire curve, all the points. E of Q is a subset of those points which are rational. So, the remarkable property of elliptic curves is that E of Q or E of R, or even if you want E of C, see, we can even treat this equation over complex number and look at all the complex solutions to this. So, those are the complex points lying on the elliptic curve. So, these form a group under addition operation, and the addition is not, this is not usual addition. Okay. And actually this is also slightly cheating because E of Q does not itself form a group, we have to throw in one more point to this. So, I should say point at infinity along with infinity. All three. Any of the three. Basically, look at the points here and then throw in one point in, which is a point at infinity. It is an abstract entity. I will make it precise later on, but to sort of intuitively just imagine it being a point lying on the curve, but which is at infinity. Okay. So now let me say what is the addition operation for the elliptic curve. So for that, let us draw the curve which I described earlier. So this is the elliptic curve, and to add two points, let us say this is point A, this is point B. We want to add A and B. To add A and B, the process is draw a line through A and B. This line is going to intersect the curve at a third point, and this is a guaranteed. Why is it guaranteed? Because it is a cubic curve. So it is guaranteed to intersect. So the equation of line is y equal to some cx plus mx plus c. So plug that in for y into y square equal to ax x cube plus ax plus b. So you get a cubic in x. It has three solutions. Okay, careful, one has to be a little careful. Either it has three solutions or it has one solution. These are the two possibilities. So if it has three solutions, okay, so because it is, this line is running through two points, so it cannot have one solution. It has to have three solutions. That is a guarantee. Third point must exist. So that is the third point. Let us call it minus c. And the reason I call minus c is will be clear in a moment. And now this is symmetric along x axis. So there is a reflection of this point below, which we will call c. And this point is the addition of a plus b. So a plus b equals c. Okay. So this process can be followed. There are some degenerate cases one has to worry about. What if this point is here, or let us say the point is, I want to add A with itself. So let us call it A prime. So A prime plus A prime, because if it is a group addition, it has to satisfy for all pairs of elements. So then again the geometric answer is simple. You draw a tangent on A prime. This tangent again is guaranteed to intersect the curve at a second point, again reflected. So these are three intersection scenarios, but there is also one intersection scenario. For example, if you take this point here, A double prime, and if you add A double prime to itself by just now what I defined, you will draw a tangent at A double prime, which is going to be a vertical line. So it intersects the curve exactly one point, which is A double prime. There is no third point it intersects, right? And this is where that point at infinity comes to our help. So because this is a vertical line going to infinity, we pretend that it is intersecting the curve at that infinite point. And this will only allow when the line is vertical. The line joining two points is vertical, then we say that the third point is, because any line that joins that is vertical is not going to intersect the third point on the curve. So that we pretend is intersecting at the end point at infinity.
Here A double prime itself is infinity, right?
No, A double prime.
A double prime is equal to minus A double prime.
Yes, but it's not infinity.
So A double prime minus. Infinity, the point at infinity is the unique.
The point at infinity actually for this group acts at the identity element of the group.
Right. So A double prime is also equal to
A double prime. So A double prime is its own inverse. So to one can easily verify that infinity is the identity. What, because if you take any point A and add infinity to it, you should get the point A. So how do you add A with infinity? Now, since infinity is associated with the vertical line, so if you want to add A and infinity, you draw a vertical line at A. Now see, what is the other point it intersects? It will intersect it at this point, which is minus a, and then the algorithm will tell us that reflect it back. Reflecting it back, you come back to a, and that's the sum. So a prime plus a plus infinity is a, and same thing you can verify other ways. Infinity plus infinity, how do you visualize that? Infinity plus infinity must be infinity. Yeah, you just can just visualize it any which way. I mean, it's like a point which never intersects, a line here, which is not intersecting it anywhere. So that's, you just pretend it's intersecting infinity at three times. No, intersect. Yeah, three times or whatever, as many times as you want. So that, these are all degenerate cases which you can just fix. And this geometric realization is just for our own understanding, really. One can give a much more precise and rigorous algebraic definition of all of this. And there, because some of these things seem to be arbitrary, which I am giving, telling you, but if you look at it algebraically, it all works out. Okay? So this is the group that sits on an elliptic curve. In fact, there are lots of groups which sit on an elliptic curve. I already identified three of them. The group over complex numbers, the group over real numbers, and the group over rationals. The group of rational points, the group of real points, and the group of complex points. Okay. And one can go further and define elliptic curves over finite fields. Again, this is simply y square equal to x cube plus ax plus b. Four a cube minus 27 b square is not zero. What?
Doesn't the field have to be algebraically closed?
Not necessarily. We can close it algebraic, so we can get different groups on the field on the curve as we proceed towards closure. Just like as in case of real and complex, for reals also these are defined. That's not algebraically closed, but I can close it to complex numbers and get another set of points, and those set of points also form a group. So similarly, this is over field F of characteristic P, and P is, I don't want P to be 2 or 3, because if P is 2 or 3, then this form of equation doesn't quite exist, because you see that this discriminant gets messed up. The pi, yeah, the y square and x cube, these are all get messed up. So there are alternative forms of the curve which hold for characteristic 2 and 3, but for the sake of simplicity, we will not consider them. So let us just concentrate on higher characteristic. Note that f q need not be the base field, that is, it f q, q must can be an arbitrary power of p. Okay? And now we can define, so this is a elliptic curve over this field. Now we can define, talk about the set of points which are points on E in FQ. And not only FQ, again as already said, we can consider, because not all points may have, not all values may have solution in FQ. That is, you plug in some value of y, now you get a cubic in x, you get three roots. Not all those three values may be in FQ. They may lie in the higher fields, extension fields. They will certainly lie in the algebraic closure of FQ. Fine. So in general, we can talk about extensions of FQ, which are of the form FQ to the K, and points lying on the curve, which are belong to this field. Now, clearly, E of FQ is the subset of E of FQ square and E of F cube, and so on. Okay. Oh, I'm out of time. Okay. Let me just close by saying that the Riemann hypothesis, which I am going to show next in the next class tomorrow, and I will prove it in the next class, is not too difficult to prove. We will have to assume some results about elliptic curve, but that is about it. Will be about these elliptic curves over finite fields, and we will show nice the zeta function for the this such curves and the nice functional equation and lots of properties. Elliptic curves over rationals are a different beast. They are not very well understood, or at least not as well understood as these. In fact, we do not even know, there is a corresponding Riemann hypothesis there, but we do not know if that Riemann hypothesis is true or not. We know something now, thanks to this result of Andrew Wiles and others, we know that the that zeta function does have a functional equation, but that is about it.